What's up, everybody? Dezz Asante here from the TechMuze Academy. With me is TechMuze Academy member Trey Marshall. Trey, how you doing, brother?
I'm doing all right. How you doing?
I can't complain myself. As I was telling you just before we started recording, we're finally getting some beautiful summer weather here just outside of Toronto, Ontario. And so, you know, that puts a smile on my face. I got a cold beer in the fridge. It's a wonderful thing.
Sweet.
So listen, man. So you are a member of the TechMuze Academy. Actually, you took the mixlessons.com program, if I'm not mistaken.
Right.
Did you ever look into the artist promotion blueprint?
I checked it out a little bit.
Okay.
I enjoyed it. I mean, it's good.
Because what you might not realize, I'm not entirely sure, maybe you saw my post on Facebook the other day, but I've kind of decided to restructure how the Academy works, and I'm not doing separate programs anymore. It's just one membership, and you get access to everything. So
Right. Okay. Adds
a little. My goal with that is to add a little more value to the members and also to make things a little simpler for myself. I'm actually just launching that. Probably by the time people are watching this, the launch will probably be underway, and I'm going to give people some discounts if they want to get in on the early bird and see how it goes.
Cool, do it.
Yeah, man. So how did you stumble on me and the TechMuze Academy?
Well, to be honest with you, I always like to seek out different teachers. You know, I've been under the recordingrevolution.com, hardcore mixers and everything. So a lot of great guys. But after a while, I like to take a different journey, if you will, to hear what other people are doing. So I just happened to find you on Facebook. I saw one of your free videos, and I was like, okay. And the way that you explain things, it was stuff that I guess I knew in the back of my head, but it just kind of brought everything to light. So I'm like, wow, so I got to check this guy out.
Right.
So then I signed up, and I got your premium membership thing, and I learned a lot there, and I've been using stuff to this day.
Excellent, excellent. Well, that's always my goal, is to make sure, you know, people feel as though they got their money's worth. Would you say that was the case?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
good.
Yeah, most definitely.
That's good, that's good. Yeah, that's another part of my reasoning for the restructuring of the Academy, is to really make sure that people feel as though I've over-delivered, because a happy customer comes back again, you know what I mean? And hopefully tells their friends, you know? So that's really good to hear. As far as the Mixed Lessons course is concerned, and you know, I'm of the belief that nothing is perfect, so, you know, my work included, right? Mm-hmm. As you were going through that, did you find any particular areas that you feel, you know, you felt maybe I could have been more clear on, or things maybe I didn't cover that you thought would have been helpful or useful? Give me a little feedback. Maybe I can improve things for the future students as well. Anything come to mind?
Well, I mean, no, not really. I mean, for me, I'm a cool breeze, man. When I go through things and I hear things that I like, you know, I hear it, I connect with it, and, you know, I use some things and just fit it to my way of working.
Right. Right.
So everything, I don't have any complaints on my end.
Good. Okay. That's great to hear. I ask that question whenever I have these conversations with other students, other members, because, you know, like I said, nothing is perfect. And if I got ways I can improve, then I'm happy to do so. And that's really my goal. I mean, although, you know, of course, obviously TechMuze is a business and it helps me to pay my bills. That's not my primary motivation. I really have a desire to make sure people are getting what they need to become successful. You know
right,
what I'm saying?
Right.
And hopefully that's the way most people feel when they come through. So listen, you had some big news a little while back. For those people watching this in the future, hopefully you're familiar with Pensado's place, Dave Pensado and his crew. They do a show weekly on YouTube, and it's just excellent. They're interviewing some of the biggest swingers in the industry, and they also run, in conjunction with Indaba Music, they run these big mix competitions. And Trey, tell us a little bit about what your experience has been with the Indaba mix competitions.
Well, the first Indaba mix competition was put on by PureMix.com, so that was really my first mix competition, and it was a different experience because I just first dabbled into mixing as a main art. You know, I've done recording, and mixing was kind of not my thing, so I just tried to focus more on the mixing side, and that contest came up, and you know, I learned a lot just from entering that contest. So right. Whenever Pensado's place did it, I had already gone through the the whole contest thing once, and you know, before you knew it, I was the most listened to mix. Got like over 400 votes and everything, and I don't know how many plays and listens.
Right.
But you know, the people really responded to it, and I think a lot of that had to do with, because I was on the top, you know, a lot of people were checking out the competition, you know, seeing. So, you know, there's been some people that kind of play it over and over again, just trying to see what's out there.
Right.
But it just kind of went out of control. And I don't know how exactly that happened. But I mean, if the people like, I personally didn't like it all that much.
Oh, really?
But because, you know, we get so focused on getting everything sounding perfect. You know, I hated the snare drum sound. And that seemed to be, from the feedback I got, that was everyone's favorite thing. So right. I was like, okay, so sort of I just let it go, let it ride, and
sort of an eye of the beholder thing, you know. It's like,
yeah,
you look at one person, you think that's a beautiful person, then another person looks at them and goes, yeah, I don't know, you know.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I suppose that happens in all walks of life, but that's impressive. But I mean, obviously one thing is not debatable, is that the mix must have been good, or else people wouldn't have liked it, people wouldn't have been listening to it, right, and voting right. for it, and so on and so forth. So whether you liked it or not, it appealed to the masses.
Right.
So can you tell us a little bit about, like, first of all, what type of tune was this? What style of production was this this competition on?
This one, the first Pensado's Place competition, was it was more of a rock alternative. The band was Regret the Hour.
Okay.
And I liked the tune.
Yeah.
I mean, I really did. And I think that's part of it, is that, you know, I just kind of mixed it and heard what I heard.
Sure.
And, you know, for the most part, it was a decent song. So, I mean, any good production is going to make a good mix.
Right.
If you don't overdo it.
Yeah.
You know?
But, yeah.
But yeah, so it was an alternative rock mix. And, you know, that's a style that I like mixing, and I like the song. So I entered.
So you had some experience working with that genre of music already. So you had a few ideas probably already cooking when you heard the raw tracks. That's that always helps. Anything come to mind when you think back on that mix? Was there anything, any particular like hurdles, apart from your issues with the snare drum, were there any particular hurdles that you kind of had to overcome? You know, did you learn any new tips or tricks with this mix?
It was all mental. Mm. You know, the thing is, you know, like I said, we overthink some things, and I get to a point where I would keep mixing it, and it's not like it's sounding better, it just sounds different.
Yeah.
So when I get to that point, I step back, I actually took some stuff off to where, okay, I think that sounds a little bit better.
Right.
And then I put it up, and I, you know, I still finish kind of early because, you know, I've got a little more wind beneath my wings, so even after me wrestling with it, it's only for maybe a couple of days. I just posted it and I left it as it was. Like, I'm not touching this thing again. And, you know, let's just move on to the next thing. But, you know, I go back and people start responding to it, and I'm like, okay, I like it.
Must have done something right.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's funny when it comes to mixing. I mean, with other parts of the production process, like, you know, with tracking, recording, what have you, there's sort of, you know, start, middle, and end points to things, you know? If you're
right.
If you're tracking a guitar, if the guitar is sounding good, the player made it, you know, performed well, and you had the mics in the right spot, and you captured it, you're done recording the guitar, you know? But when it comes to mixing, you, like you said, you can just go round and round and round the bush, because there's always things that can be tweaked and changed, and sometimes you got to learn to feel, you know, when to, if you're a painter, you know, when to put the brush down. You know,
right,
what I mean?
Because
you can keep putting more paint on and tweaking things all day long, right? And at a certain point in time, you run the risk of sort of mixing the life right out of the production, right?
Yeah.
And that's that's an important point. And I know it's a kind of ambiguous thing to talk about, because it's a little different for everybody. It's a very subjective thing, you know.
Right.
But it's something that I believe needs to be learned at some point along the process when it comes to mixing, because, like, I've done it. I've been there. I've done the whole mixing round and round and round. And then before you know it, you bounce it out, and the rough mix is like, that's the one I'm going to give. It's like, after you know, four weeks of listening to this tune, you know what? Here, have the rough mix that we did in half an hour the first day. It sounds better.
Yeah. Yeah, that's usually the mix that you closest to what you start out with, that's usually the best one.
Yeah, yeah. And like you mentioned, if you start with a great production, if the tracks are nice and clean and well recorded, if the arrangement is well thought out, a lot of those decisions sort of take care of themselves, and you're just sort of putting the sparkle on, putting everything together, distributing things three-dimensionally so that everyone, you know, everything has its place, and then you know, hit the print button and off you go, right?
Yeah.
Let me ask you this. When it came to this mix that we're talking about, I'm focusing on this mix for obvious reasons because, you know, you did really good in the competition. And when you posted that for the first time in the Facebook group, the mix lessons group, I was like, I did a little click my heels. It's like, you know, that's one of my boys right there, you know?
Right? So yeah.
I definitely wanted to come on and get you, you know, I want to brag about it on your behalf, you know? So.
Well, thank you. Appreciate it.
So with this session, can you think of any particular techniques that you utilized? You know, I mean, some people watching are at various different levels in their skill set, their abilities, right?
Right.
So, you know, some people are just figuring out how to pan stuff out, how to use their compressors, how to use an EQ and whatnot, some of that basic stuff that, you know, that everyone needs to know if they're into this. But, you know, just beyond that, perhaps, was there anything that comes to mind when you think back of this mix that you thought, hey, that was pretty cool, or that worked out really well?
Well, this mix, again, instead of dealing with raw tracks, it was almost like these were processed stems that we're mixing. And, you know, I had to do more of a hands-off approach because I loaded up the session. To me, it sounded great,
right,
as it was, but there were just some things that I would do differently. So since this isn't a client giving me a list of demands, I was like, okay, I'll go ahead and fix those things that I like. But see, this mix, I've never mixed this style before. Mm. So I was really out of my comfort zone. I didn't even know what to use for a reference, but I was just like, okay, I'm just going to go for balance and clarity. Yeah. And that's, you know, that's what else can you ask for,
really?
And it was, I mean, the production was good. They obviously know what they wanted.
Yeah.
So I just kind of let that lead me, and I just balanced it out, made sure you could hear everything, and I uploaded it, and
the rest is history.
Yeah.
So if we can arrange it through the wonders of modern technology and editing, what I'd like to do is play your mix at the end of this conversation so people can actually hear what you've done. And maybe if like we were speaking about before we hit record there, if you're able to send me an unmixed version as well so we can kind of compare, that'd be fantastic. And and, you know, give, just to give the listeners an opportunity to sort of hear exactly what you did, because I know for me it took a long time before like, you know, messing around with this and practicing and studying and whatnot, took me a long time to really appreciate what the mix engineer is doing. Because when you hear a commercial record, you're hearing the final product. So you're hearing the tracking engineers, you're hearing the mix guy, you're hearing the mastering, you're hearing it all at once, and you don't really know how much of it did this cat do, you know?
Right.
And so you know, the first time I got an opportunity to hear something well recorded but unmixed, and I had the same reaction you had. It's like, oh, this already sounds good. You know, what do I do from here, right? The epiphany for me was a number of years ago, Waves, the plugin company, they released a little tutorial set that was a promotional tool for their plugins, where you could download the demos of their plugins and download this session of raw audio tracks, and then you could, you know, learn how to mix a track using their plugins in the hopes that you're going to buy them from them, right?
Okay.
And I thought, oh, I'll check this out. And I downloaded the session. I dropped it into Cubase. That's my DAW of choice right there. Represent, right? And and I hit play, and I was like, huh. And I realized at that moment that 80 or more percent of the work I used to do was not mixing at all. It was fixing.
Right.
And that last, you know, 10-15% was where I was starting from with this session from Waves. And I thought, oh man, like this was a revolution for me. You know what I mean? In the way I think. And it also made me realize how much work I had to do at the production side, you know? Because if I'm tracking these sessions and then I get to the mix phase and I'm still spending 80% of my time fixing and not mixing, then I must need some work on that part of the process.
Right.
So that was a good, you know, 15, 20 years ago or so. I don't know how long ago. At least a decade and a half ago. And of course, you know, from there, I've come a long way. But now I realize, and tell me what you think of this, but now I realize that I get to my static mix, my rough mix, relatively quickly these days, unless there's a lot of editing to do, but I normally charge a whole extra job for the editing.
Right.
And because that's a tedious process. It certainly can be. But then I realized that I get to my static mix these days relatively quickly. And then from there, I spend a great deal of my time on the fine-tuning and the automation and the breathing that life into the mix. You know how I like to speak, right? That life into the mix. And I find now that's where I end up spending most of my time. And that's also where you start to really hear that, you know, the fingerprint of the mix engineer, their character, their creativity. How do you approach that in your work, not just this session, but in your work in general? Do you dive into that automation stuff a lot? Do you consider that whole listener journey as you're mixing?
Yeah. One thing that I've realized is that you get better at doing what you keep doing.
Yeah.
So you keep doing something, you're going to get better at it. And whenever I start mixing, the first thing I do is before I even mix it, I listen to the song and find out what direction I want to take this. You know, where does it need to go? And I have to balance out what do I want versus what does the song need?
Yeah.
Because sometimes we just put on a little extra sparkle because, you know, we feel like we have all these tools. Why not use them?
Yeah.
And we throw everything at a mix. But, you know, like you said, it's a listener journey.
Yeah.
So half the stuff that we do, the end listener's not even going to care about it because they care about the whole experience. So I've learned as a mixer to hide behind the music and not try to say, oh, look what I can do to a mix. It's like, what does the song need? I'm here to serve the song.
Yeah.
So I listen to the song. And really, like you said, the static mix gets, you know, you get there pretty quickly because if it's a good production and you're just mixing, all you're doing is balancing. You have a roadmap of where you want to go. So static mix is pretty quick, and you know it's all about the automation.
Yeah.
You know, no track sits in a mix perfectly 100% of the time.
Yeah.
Unless they really do that in the production phase, and you know that'd be nice. I haven't had one yet, but that would be nice. But yeah, so automation, you know, that's like you said, it's what breathes life into it. You know, you can take people on the journey, but if I want the listener to pay attention to something in their left ear, well, that's what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
And I can, I'm their tour guide.
Yeah.
Through the song, and I'll lead them where I want them to go.
Absolutely. Tour guide. I like that analogy. That's exactly how it is. Welcome to my musical world. Let me show you around.
Yeah.
That's good. All right. So you got a little production company on the go yourself. You're doing work for clients, are you?
Yeah. It's getting there. I mean, I usually quite cautious of who I pick up, but yeah, I do. So I don't like just put it out there. Hey, send me your mix. But, right. But I do have clients. I do have people that I work for, and they're repeat clients too. So that's always good.
Yeah. That tells you something. It means you did it right. That's awesome. Yeah. So how long you been doing this now, you know, professionally, like making dollars from it?
Oh man, I'm still green as far as that goes.
Yeah.
But after, you know, that first Pensado's Place mix competition, that's when things really start to take off.
Absolutely.
So, you know, kudos for that.
That's almost as good as an endorsement from the man himself, you know?
Yeah, almost.
So this time next year, we should see you on the show then, right? Pensado's Place?
Definitely. I'll be the guy handing him his coffee right before the show starts.
Yeah, right. Well, listen, if you ever do get on Pensado's Place, give TechMuze a shout out.
Yes, definitely.
That's awesome, man. So listen, if people want to check out what you're doing, you got a website up people can see? Or are you active in particular social channels that people can follow you?
My website's under construction right now, but it's treyrocks.com.
Trey Rocks.
And then my Facebook is facebook.com/treyrocks. And I'm pretty active in social media and everything like that. So right. I got a Facebook, Twitter, and all that other stuff. So it's cool.
Excellent, excellent. Well, listen, brother, what we should do is get you hooked up with the new version of the TechMuze Academy membership so that you can start digging into the artist promotion blueprint, get that website making money for you. Right? You know, by the way, there's a couple other courses that I'm in the process of creating that I'm adding into the community now. One of them is a deep dive, a sort of A to Z Facebook advertising for musicians, Facebook marketing for musicians, covering both organic marketing, the kind of marketing that doesn't cost you money but takes time, and paid marketing, the kind that does cost you money but happens very quickly, right?
Yeah.
And of course, my people are musicians, but the concepts and the techniques can be applied to you running yourself as a musician, as an artist, or, you know, running your production company, running your business as a mix engineer, running your business selling donuts on the corner, whatever it is. If you're trying to collect money from somebody for what you do, what you have to offer, then, you know, learning how to market yourself is very important. I mean, we talk a lot about that in the Artist Promotion Blueprint, of course, but the Artist Promotion Blueprint is more of like a wide overview, covering everything from like how to build a website from scratch all the way up to how to optimize the site so that it's more than just an online brochure, so that it actually does something for you, you know, on autopilot, how to grow an email list, how to nurture those fans and how to, you know, when it's appropriate to give them an offer and all of these different things, how to monetize your music and so on and so forth. It's very broad and very in-depth. Whereas this new course is very specifically on using the power of the biggest social platform on the planet right now to really accelerate your progress, both organically and with paid traffic. So that's going to be added to the community as well. And I'm also doing a course on basic music theory for songwriters and producers. I don't know if you caught that. Do you follow TechMuze on YouTube at all?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so a little while ago, a few months ago, I put out four short videos that were the sort of the intro to this basic music theory for musicians, songwriters, and producers, and it got so much great feedback that I thought, okay, well, that was four videos. I'm going to make this into a whole course, so I'm going to throw that in the community as well for the TechMuze members. So I don't know. What do you think about this? In your honest opinion, from your perspective, having dealt with TechMuze before and other educators as well, do you think this is a good move? give all the students everything for one price instead of, you know, buy this, buy that, buy the other?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, especially with so many DAWs and plug-in companies, it seems like they want to take money from you.
Yeah.
You know, I keep getting emails from Wave saying you need to update your coverage or whatever.
Of course.
We can edit that out later. I mean, you know, that's where my heart is about providing value.
Yeah.
You know, because at the end of the day, I mean, they pay for it, they're invested in it, and it's up to everyone to do what they will with it. But, you know, like you said, they're going to keep coming back. And if you support them, you know, they'll support you.
Yeah.
And that's another big key in Indaba, is that it's a community. So, you know, people that support them and everything else. So that all just helps build greater success.
Absolutely.
So, you know, if that's what's on your heart to do, then I say go for it, because there are people that will appreciate it.
Awesome. Yeah. And like I said earlier, it makes it a bit easier for me to manage too, because now there's just one community, there's one, you know, subscription, there's one, you know, bank of customers to support. And instead of, you know, logging into the Mixed Lessons group and saying hey, and then logging into Artist Promotion and saying hey,
right.
And now it's just all under one roof. We can all talk about everything, anything that's going to be helpful. You know, you can
you
get support and be supportive as well. And I really am big on the community. Now, of course, one of the interesting little hurdles that I have is that in with the new TechMuze community, obviously I haven't launched it yet, so there ain't nobody in there talking to each other yet, right? So another one of the reasons why I want to have you on is see if you might be interested in just a complimentary account over there, just to I'll give it to you for free, and just to, you know, if you'll log in sometime here and there and spark conversations, show off your work, this and that, and then of course you can feel free to check out all the other courses as well. Would you be down with something like that?
Don't mind if I do.
All right. Somehow I suspected you might say that. And listen, too, for anyone who might be watching this in the future, if they're kind of on the fence as to whether or not to join the TechMuze community, being someone who has experience with it, what would you tell them?
I'd say listen to the tracks that you're going to hear at the end of this video.
Proof is in the pudding.
The proof is in the pudding.
Yeah. You got to invest in yourself, right? And,
right.
You know, it's a lot of fun to buy new gear and buy new plugins. But, you know, investing in your own skill development, I think, is equally important, if not more important. And yes. You say you've taken some courses from Graham Cochran as well over at Recording Revolution. I mean, he's one of the biggest proponents of look what you can do with a $500 studio. You know what I mean? It's about knowing which knobs to twist, not how many knobs you have.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? That's awesome.
Yes, sir.
Listen, man, I appreciate you taking the time to chat with me.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, no, my pleasure. We've been trying to do this for a little while. We've had some technical hiccups and whatnot, but we finally got a chance to meet face to face. And now I can put a face to the name when we're chatting in the forums and whatnot, and I really enjoy that as well. So we're gonna send people over to treyrocks.com.
Yes.
Okay. So you say it's under construction right now, but who knows? It may be up and running by the time people have a look at this. And just before we wrap it up, anything else you want to part with? Any questions you have for me? Anything like that? Any advice you have for some new mixers?
Let's see. Well, the best thing that I can tell anyone that's starting this from scratch is less is more.
Yeah.
Less is more. I mean, I don't know how much time I've spent, you know, like going through that loop. And if I would have just realized it's not about, you know, it's not about the gear, it's about your ears.
Yeah.
So, you know, you invest in your training, invest in your listening environment, because it doesn't matter what you throw at a mix. If what you're hearing is inaccurate,
yeah.
you know, you're doing a lot of cleanup after the fact.
Totally.
So those are the most time consuming things that I've dealt with.
Yeah.
So if you learn that early on, then you'll just be even that much more further ahead.
Absolutely agree with that. I think it's something that we all come to learn at some point or another. And if you can kind of focus on that early, like you say, you'll have much more productive time during the rest of your learning process. Awesome, man. Trey Marshall, thanks for hanging out with me. And everybody go check out treyrocks.com, facebook.com/treyrocks if you want to reach out and say hello. Thanks once again, brother, and we'll talk again soon.
All right, talk to you soon.
All right.
Trust, do you care? Tell me.